So I think that the flow state that you talked about that makes us connected is the release of our right brain. It's the letting go of the negativity and that 100-pound stress vest that we've been wearing all week. And then the left brain aspect of art is, like I said before, much like playing the piano. It's like learning the scales, practicing every day. You add more things to your repertoire. You're getting better at it.
Welcome to episode 67 of Synchronicity. My guest this week is Jerry Cannon from Infinite Bit. And I'm going to be honest here. I've done about 9 or 10 takes at this intro. I'm having a hell of a day. I'm going to play some Bob Marley. So we can all listen to that for a little bit. And then I'm going to come back and tell you what's going on in this episode.
Rise up this morning. Smile with the rising sun.
Isn't that nice, listening to Bob Marley? It relaxed me. I know that. So let's talk about what's going on in Synchronicity world this week. I don't know why I chose to say that. Synchronicity Book Club is starting on February 1st, 2017. We selected a book in the Facebook group. If you don't know what I'm talking about, all of the information you will ever need about this show, this podcast, anything that's going on is on syncpodcast.com, synccpodcast.com. But there is a Facebook group for this podcast. In that Facebook group, we have selected a book democratically, and the book is The Toltec Art of Living and Dying by Don Miguel Ruiz. This isn't actually a book that I put up for auction. No, that's not right. In the poll, but I'm really excited to read it. It's starting in February. Pick up that copy if you want to get involved. Join the Facebook group. We're going to talk about it. We're going to do some hangouts, some video stuff. I think it'll be cool. I know it'll be cool, actually. I know it's going to be cool. So that's going on. Before I go any further with anything related to this podcast or me, I want to talk about Jerry. Jerry is super fucking cool. My friend Michelle introduced us, I want to say like 2 months ago. Jerry was actually in the middle of moving to Colorado, I believe from Philadelphia. Correct me if I'm wrong, Jerry. Let me know. He was going through his move, but he found the time right when he moved to Denver. None of his stuff had arrived to sit down and chat with me about a lot of stuff. And in particular, one of our common interests is trying to figure out how to create systems, models, paradigms that allow creatives and creators to benefit financially, socially, so they can create art without necessarily having to be totally on top of running a business. Because nowadays, like in case you haven't noticed, creative professionals, like that's the thing now. It's, you know, it wasn't just you're a creative person. Now you have to be a creative professional if you want to kind of live in the world, whether you're a graphic designer, whether you're a writer, whether you're a musician, whether you're a painter. These are all things like you either hire someone to help you with some of this stuff or you do it yourself. So creating things that benefit artists and creators is something that Jerry and I are both passionate about, and really protecting artists and creators too, because one of the things, and this is, if you listen to any of the podcasts with Vic Berger, you know, we've alluded to it, but people steal his stuff all the time. And Jerry even talks about in this podcast, you know, a company he worked for stole his art and just sold it. And that's a big issue. So we touch on a lot of that, which is, to me, since I've gone out into the world and made money by working with and for other people, you know, the ethical component of business and trying to figure out for the people who really seem like they deserve it, how to get those people rewarded. So that's what this is about. More to the point, Jerry is just a really, really nice dude. We've been connected on Facebook for a while. He's funny. He's cool. He's incredibly creative and he's grounded. And he talks about some dark times in his life. He alludes to them. But I can tell you from speaking with him, he's got his shit together. So without further ado, we're getting to it this week because overwhelm has hit the Lampert household. Without further ado, here is Jerry Cannon. What's going on, man?
Hey Noah, how are you?
How you doing? I'm good. How are you? How's the move?
Well, I'm getting my moving pod tomorrow. Oh. Like it's going.
You're just not in charge of it going. It's coming.
Exactly. Well, it's better on this side of it, I'll tell you that much. Being out in Colorado already better.
Yeah, I bet, man. Dude, I'm super happy we can do this and I'm glad. I mean, even though your stuff's not there, at least we can connect. Where specifically are you in Colorado again?
So I'm in Erie, which is about 25 minutes east of Boulder and say 35 north of Denver. Anybody that's from here, sorry, wrong on that.
I have friends who I think live in the Denver area, but I haven't been to Colorado ever. And I know that it's just like a really cool place now. Why did you decide to move to Colorado?
A number of things, actually. I have some help out here that are some of my closest friends that would be more than willing to help with my company as it grows. Mm. I might not have the money to bring in people that I don't know that don't care about my business.
Yeah.
Trying to scrounge to get by in Philadelphia, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, there's some great people there. I've had an awesome time. But I did a COSM class with Chris Dyer. I think it was last summer. It might have been summer before. My memory's not always the best. But one of the things he said about becoming an artist and about furthering your journey is if where you're at isn't doing it for your art scene, if it's not where it's the most celebrated, then you need to work to get there. Mm. And then that was kind of the point that I started looking around going, okay, I'm going to pick a couple locations. I'm going to see how these pan out and see where I end up. And at the end of the day, Colorado, it's got a lot of artists, you know.
Yeah.
So about the migration, I think it's a wonderful place. So
let's just consider that we got started, even though we're just meeting face to face, although we've spoken a couple times on the phone. So I do want to start primarily with your business, but more as kind of a exposition into this creative community, artistic, artist-driven systems that are starting to emerge, right? We've all heard, if you've been involved in any creative scene for a long time, that, you know, artists are going to have to survive in this creative professional future. And, you know, it behooves all artists to understand business in some sense. But then you and I, even in our conversations, were like, you know, we're lucky enough that we're both artistic and have some semblance of an idea how to sift through and process some business stuff, right? But I know a lot of people on the spectrum who just have either little to no tolerance, which is where I'd probably put myself in the little tolerance, to absolutely none, being like, it's not a question of them not wanting to learn it or they don't have the patience to learn. They just don't have that part of the brain where it's wired together to be like, oh, this is how I build my business as an artist. And then we'll get into like the function of art and why this stuff isn't just like us pursuing fancies because we just want to entertain ourselves. But I definitely want to start like, because you have a business, Infinite Bit. You've been in and around creative scenes. And I would just love your perspective on kind of, and I also just want to say before we get to that,
I totally relate to trying to identify a place you want to center your business and your life and pick. And, you know, that's why we chose the Hudson Valley, like specifically. And it's awesome you mentioned Cosm, because we're like 40 minutes away from there. That was a huge reason. I've never been. I've met the Grays like behind the stage at a Duncan Trussell thing once, and they were super cool. But I know what's going on there, and I can feel the vibes and energy, and like, not to get too woo-woo about it, but like, I know that that is like a cultural hub for where I want to be. So, okay, I know I said a lot, but maybe you could start about kind of the creative communities that are emerging and how that fits into your life and what's going on.
So I've seen a lot of different, as you said, movements kind of emerge over the years. And I don't think that talent is the identifier in what the longest lived thing is.
Yeah.
And to me, that is like this gut disappointment. I see somebody that is working so hard. And as you said, maybe they don't have the part of the brain that's wired to understand how to pick up and run a business and what's necessary to do. And as far as, I do want to comment on that too for a second. I think it's like anything. It's like riding a bike. It's like maybe like learning a piano would be better. You're not going to sit down and learn all the scales in one day. Right. But as technology improves and grows, a lot of what even the goal of artists in tech is to make this more user-friendly, to make it so the people that didn't design this but are there to use it are going to be able to understand what they're doing.
Yes.
So if you're a struggling artist, maybe make friends with a tech entrepreneur, right? See what you can do.
Yeah.
But I think as far as the movements go, I wanted to be able to bring a fair and equal platform for these artists to create apparel and prints and all sorts of different things without having to worry about like, hey, who's behind this? This person now has my art prints. They have my raw art. What are they going to do with it? How do I see where they're actually selling this? Like, to be completely honest, and to any other business out there that might be listening too, like, it's $30 to $60 a month for a pretty in-depth vendor tracking app that will make artists feel comfortable. I'm not holding that as a trade secret. That's something I feel the entire industry should move forward with. Like,
right.
You should see your sales. That's it. You're the artist. You caused this to sell. That's it.
Right. But that's such a, you say it as though like it's a novel concept, although we know like that's, it shouldn't be like that's base level, like, especially when we're going to get to this, but when you're talking about direct to consumer or direct to fan or direct to customer relationships, like, you definitely need to know what's going on. Like, you don't have to be a statistician and an analytics guru, but to have some idea of the response and then the signals you get from your stuff, it's like, yeah, I totally get it, man.
I think I've had some experiences, and I'm not going to drop names, but I've had some experiences where people have even taken my art. And there's several companies that are out there, and there's a lot of artists that reach out to me now because they know some of my experiences with, like, finding that, okay, my art got stolen. All right, I need to get copyright. So I get my copyright. And then I find out, hey, if I had them before, I could have got a, like, six figures. But because I got them after, I'm only entitled to what profits they're going to show on the books.
Right.
And then the time it takes for an artist and the amount of money it would take in lawyer fees to fight someone like this, it's kind of become something people have preyed upon. So there's probably 5 to 10 companies that have popped out of these emerging art scenes where other people are realizing that, hey, people want to immerse themselves in their art beyond the experience of looking at art on the wall.
Right.
And I think that's where my time in college was too. I went for interactive art and design, and I strongly feel that everything art should, it evokes an interaction.
Right.
Whether you're looking at a piece or not, the one that you love when you look at it, it evokes an emotional response. It evokes thought. It is an interaction between you and that piece. And at the same time, I think that these pieces of clothing and the things that represent the artist, having a bit of an artist touch behind the scenes and being able to know where your sales are, if you could solve those two things, there'd be a lot of companies flourishing doing this, and artists would have a lot more money.
Yeah, and I mean, it's just like a basic thing that follows suit, that like the more power we can put in the hands or can be put in the hands of people who are creating this stuff, and the easier it is for them, because like I think anyone who's a creative or a non-creative, there's this flow state you get into, right? I mean, it's commonly talked about with athletes, particularly because there's not a lot of thinking going on at peak level physical performance. You're reacting and the training is paying off and you're in this flow state. In the same way with artistic endeavors, like I know this from making music for, you know, 15 plus years on my computer. if you don't have a high proficiency in the tools you're using and you have to keep going back and analyzing or checking something, how do I do that? That'll fuck up your entire creative process, whether it's learning the guitar, selling something online, painting something like that. Needs those barriers. And this is what you're talking about, I think, with technology is technology can be used as a tool to make that part of the process easier for people so they don't have to devote a ridiculous amount of time to learning and crafting a whole new set of tools that aren't necessarily applicable to their creative process.
Yeah, man,
I feel you.
I actually did take a couple notes too. I was listening to a few of your talks and thinking about over here. So I'm going through this here for a second. I wanted to start this whole thing too.
Yeah.
Just want to say to any artist anywhere, go to LegalZoom.com or do a Google search for websites similar to LegalZoom.com. It costs $150 per work or $170 for every work up until that point to be copyrighted. Mm-hmm. And then you're protected. And then if something happens, you really have some force behind your cease and desist and say, hey, you're going to owe us a lot of money right now.
Right. Yeah.
I think that's the only way to stop the whole theft thing. And I'm going to touch on what you just said in a second, too.
Yeah, no, and it's incredibly important to point out the legal ramifications. Like my mom is a lawyer, my grandfather was a lawyer. I have good friends who are lawyers. I could never be a lawyer, but I do recognize that we do have the legal system in place, however faulty it can be, to protect people if you use it, and like tools like LegalZoom and getting like the right, certifications and, incorporations if you need to, is super duper important. So I'm glad you pointed that out.
And as far as structuring what I think left and right brain is, I think that the staying focused and realizing that a business does require a whole lot of left brain focus isn't always the easiest thing for the artist type, especially those that might smoke some pot and, have a whole lot more creative, lofty field I have that I work with that are that way, that are wonderful people, and I couldn't expect them to try to micromanage Google AdWords for so I think that the flow state that you talked about that makes us connected is the release of our right brain. It's the letting go of the negativity and that 100-pound stress vest that we've been wearing all week. And then the left brain aspect of art is, like I said before, much like playing a piano, just like learning the scales, practicing every day. You add more things to your repertoire. You're getting better at it. Yeah. And the same goes for art. It's about learning something new, being the best you every day. It's not about achieving that totally realistic sense. But I think the combination of the left with the right brain is what creates that true sense of accomplishment in a piece. Mm. That is, it relieved you of that emotional whatever the negativity we want to call it is. And it also allowed you to further your progress at the same time. And that's like that happy place for artists that I think of.
Well, this is a fascinating thing because I'm getting to this point with my own creativity and my own projects where I'm becoming more and more satisfied each step of the way. And then now actually in completing works and projects. And I've noticed that there is a balancing. I'm asking a lot of my friends who are both artists and business owners, the question I've been asking them, like, do you consider yourself more of a person who like intuitively figures out what their next step is? Or do you plan out strategically exactly what's going on? Because my natural tendency is to be far more intuitive and kind of like figure out what's going on. But recently, in the past year, 2 years, partially because of where my business has gone, but also partially because this is just for my own, I'm recognizing the value in this, I've started to specifically plan strategic things out. And the balance I've noticed, exactly like you said, I think this is a fascinating thing. I never thought about it like this. You are able to let go of the more kind of unpredictable emotional components that go into art, which can be very limiting. I mean, I can tell you without a fact, I've never not finished a piece of music because I didn't have a plan in place to finish it. I've not finished it because I've let emotions and my own perceptions color what I'm doing at the time, where even if I go back and listen like 2 years later, I'm like, holy shit, why did I stop this? It's fucking good. But my emotional content and surrounding. So being able to drop that by integrating and kind of bridging these two hemispheres of what's going on really does. I think it counterintuitively helps with everything. It helps with getting the work done, appreciating it, satisfaction, then you build momentum. And it's this very interesting thing that I think a lot of people are noticing. Okay. All right, listen, this is all, we're talking about these theoretical. I want to find out about you specifically and kind of, I know where you're from. I know you're into hockey from our Facebook chats, but like, how did, and I know we have our mutual friend, Michelle, who's amazing. But how did you kind of get onto this path where you are now? For people who can't see what you look like, you're wearing pretty fucking awesome clothing. I'll try to get a picture. You got to send me this, like take a selfie or something and I can include it with this episode. But obviously a very creative person and focus on, you know, enriching people who are artists, not enriching, but like just financially, but really allowing people to integrate in the process of being an artist and be successful and be content. So how did you get on this path? Like where, what was the trajectory here?
I went down the wrong path first.
As it always seems to happen, right?
Yeah, I probably shouldn't have done. Went some wrong places, went through some heartaches, you know, and I hit some rock bottoms a couple times there and decided that I wanted better than that. And I looked at a lot of the people around, like I said, that had amazing talent and that weren't prospering. And I thought, you know, I went to school for computers. I understand at least a little bit about how design integrates into that part of the world. And I started kind of seeking more similar-minded people then. That's sort of when I kind of even ran into Michelle, was she was sort of starting her endeavor, Soul Bloom, around the same time that Infinite Bit had just popped up. And we had a long talk for like 12 hours at a Freeform Festival probably 4 years back, just about how, you know, our vision for where art is going to go. And I think even in that actual instance of communicating with somebody else that shared a vision like that, it opened my eyes to just how connected it was. So I went and I worked for some other companies too. Let me rewind a little bit here. Companies that did some dye sublimation work and worked in the clothing industry. I've worked for some people that do e-commerce at a larger scale. And then I spent some time vicariously working within a large sublimation facility for a company within a company there. It's one of the bigger ones in the country. And really saw how it runs and how the focus on efficiency, I didn't think was innovating new products at all. And I kind of made that decision there as a digital artist that there's only so many ways that I can physically hold my artwork. And I started being like, I love this. Like I can throw colors all over it and wear it and go out and be awesome. And the reaction I got was fantastic. And I started sharing that with other artists who related from some sense of, oh, I want this product. Oh, I tried this before and it didn't work out because I didn't trust the person or whatever that was. I think it was the big boost of enthusiasm there. It kept it going in the beginning past where I've seen some other people kind of hit some rocky points. But I think opening it up to the other artists to really get involved in the beginning was the success. I guess paired with some talks with a lot of other people, becoming a necessity versus or paired with loving what I do in that sense really fueled it. Some knowledge from the actual industry, some influence from all the artists that I know. You know, it's hard to like really pinpoint like, yeah, what was that moment that I was like, I know I want to do this, or like, what was the key thing that geared me towards it?
Yeah. Some people have those, but some people like there are certain things sometimes you can look back and identify those, but especially if you're still going through the transitional process, I mean, we could argue that that's always going on. It does feel kind of more like a confluence of like factors and situations and circumstances and obviously intent and work and practice are involved in it. But I know exactly what you're saying. It's not like, oh, I can look back to this one specific thought I had and, oh, of course, that put me onto this trajectory. But it does feel like these things going. But I mean, what were some of the other things? I mean, you mentioned also, and I can tell you, this podcast has been the biggest teaching for me in this is talking with other people about whatever it is. It doesn't have to be for business ideas. It could be anything. That teaches you more, I feel like, than almost anything else. Having another person to bounce ideas off of and just discuss things. So that's huge. Yeah. I mean, I get that.
Finding your own teachers is probably one of the most fulfilling things in life too. Mm-hmm. Like enjoying learning and experiencing, like in my case, the creative process with a lot of these other people that have dedicated so much time to what they love and what they enjoy about their creative process and getting to kind of openly share that with each other. And I missed that after art school, like, you know.
Yeah.
I had one of my buddies over the other day, and I was like, what do you think about this piece I bought the other day? What do you think about this artist? He's like, oh, it's cool. And I knew that. I was like, yeah, fuck you. Like, don't tell me it's cool. Tell me why it's cool. Tell me what you like about it. Like, we did 4 years of school together, and he was a painting major. There shouldn't be an excuse there. I love him to death. But he gave me the real one after. So.
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's in discussing. Well, and you mentioned before we, I was asking you about this, like this quality of, and I don't think it's just art. Art is such a nebulous term that we can use, but really anything that is created with intention. I think the reason, I just had Simon Hayduk on and he, we were talking about this, and I know a book that you picked up at, on my recommendation, who I had on, Don F. Simon, who's amazing. We discussed this too, which is this idea that what you're actually communicating with a piece of art or any work isn't the actual piece itself, but it's the process of what was going on as it was taking place that's ultimately communicated. And really effective artists, quote unquote, like successful ones, and John is very clear about this. He says, really successful ones intuitively or artificially create stories around the process itself to create meaning for the work. And some of it is authentic, but some of it is manufactured. And I think that's why we see, I mean, cause like, I mean, who hasn't on Facebook seen, and this always bothers me so much. And I always point it out and flag it, but like I'll see Tim and Eric fans, you know, Steve Brule fans. And what it is people who have taken images from Steve Brule and Tim and Eric. They're just manufacturers. They've blazoned them on their apparel and are pretending to be official licensings of the Steve Brule and Tim and Eric stuff. And like, it's just a ripoff. Like, and they're, Tim and Eric get no benefit from that. John C. Reilly doesn't. But this is obviously now, this is an art in the sense of trying to fulfill some, you know, existential need and communicate some authentic truth. But this is art being commerce. I mean, I would argue it's obviously not art and it's just a product that's being sold. But like, what do you say about this stuff? Yeah.
So I actually really recently watched, and I think everybody can go find it on YouTube, there is a talk on fan art and copyright from the owner of DeviantArt, who was formerly a trade lawyer. And he was talking a lot about, basically, he came down with the hammer and was like, you cannot sell anything fan art at all. And what you can do is you can make it, you can display it, you can show it on these platforms, and if it gets big enough, these people might reach out to you. And he gave a story about one of the big comic owners coming and saying, hey, you made this amazing fan art. I want to sell these for the next year and do an entire run of these.
Right.
The artists picked out. But when you look at the percentage of people that are going to get that offer, it's not right. And that's why I think there's this really hard discrepancy that there needs to be more ethics in the people that are in these positions to handle the manufacturing and stuff. Like, I'm really on the fence when an artist that has two kids that's struggling to get by comes to me and says, I've got this awesome piece of fan art that I spent 20 hours drawing, and it happens to have something that was a piece of pop art that is her favorite show or something, but it's done in her own way. And there's always that fear that's like, do you email it to the person and you see? And I think the answer is always yes, even though you visibly know it's going to be a letdown.
I have a side parallel story to this that I've dealt with a lot in my career. So in representing various teachers, I can mention this specifically, the Ram Dass Foundation, is there's a lot of people who really love Ram Dass, and they'll go and they'll put up videos of talks or books. And some people are just copyright violators. There are people who are turning on monetization and they don't give a fuck about this. They know that people will care about it and they'll try to make their $50 off, you know, 25,000 views, and they're happy. Some people are just doing it because they genuinely love Ram Dass and want people to see this. And this is a age old discussion, especially with wisdom teachings that Socrates had with the Sophists, which was you shouldn't be charging people for wisdom. And I 100% unequivocally agree. That said, there are many different permutations of communicating wisdom. Now, so I'll tell you how we dealt with it. And this is something I had to spearhead and kind of come up with. We developed the stock letter that we would send out to every person who we could clearly see wasn't doing this necessarily maliciously. Some people were doing it to create a product that they were intending to sell. And this still goes on, and I won't mention people's name, but I got in some disagreements with people online who were upset when eventually we had a copyright flag a few people. But we would send out originally this letter that said, listen, we totally understand that you love Ram Dass's teachings. We understand that you want as many people to see this as possible. We share this mission with you. Right now, we're in the process of organizing, collecting all of Ram Dass's teachings and putting them on YouTube for free. So we're not holding this up behind a paywall to gate it. We don't believe in that. But because we're doing that, we want it to be unified and organized. So when someone searches for something, they go, no, A, this is official. B, this is something that is organized and named correctly. And C, we're going to provide extra information and resources that are further enhance this experience. So we hope you understand that we're asking you to remove this. No problem. No worries. Obviously, some people would get back and they'd be like, okay, I totally get it. Like, no problem. Sorry, I didn't even know this was an issue. Some people would be like, you know, I spent a really long time getting this together and I put it together myself. And I think it's really fucked up that you don't want to have this up. And I can't believe you're doing this. And I'm like, listen, I understand what you're saying. But in this day and age, I understand that a lot of people don't focus on copyright violations and law. But like, when you create something that is on your own, that you love, you have to eventually understand that if you plan to make any money from it, the first step is like getting in touch with the people who own the copyrights. And if you don't, and this is echoing what you said, if you don't do that, it's not necessary. It's not like guaranteed that you're going to run into a difficult position. But something like that happened with something else of Ram Dass's, and we had to flag a guy, and he was basically doing this pattern. He was a big fan of Ram Dass, Terrence McKenna, all of these people, and he was putting together pretty good movies about them, but it was just aggregated clips, and I was like, man, like, I don't have a problem with it, okay? But understand that if someone does, you're totally out there on a limb. Like, if it was me, if I love something and I wanted to make like a 20-hour investment into a project, I would know that I don't ever plan to make any money from that. But if I still want to do it and I'm really doing it for the love of it, it wouldn't matter. So I also understand this is like a very weird line to fall in, but like most things, I think it falls in line with intention. And the channels, unfortunately, aren't here that there's like a direct fan art profit system yet. But I'm sure as artists, creators, creative professionals get better at this stuff, these systems are emerging. I know you're specifically working on them. I'm specifically working on them. Like, there's a lot of people who get that these are the issues that are kind of preventing a lot of people from even believing that being an artist, being a creative, is even a viable profession. Right.
That's so heartbreaking. And that's really where we're at in this country too. You've seen so much of that in the last few months, especially that like the artists in this country aren't not being valued as much, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, man. I hear you. Well, okay. So back to your creative path, like what you're also an artist, like what got you started in that? How long have you kind of had that? I mean, I kind of know the answers to these, but like what got you into creating your own stuff, and B, what kind of propelled you forward once you're like, I like doing this, and what we were like, you know what I'm asking.
I'm going to give you a couple little answers about this too. Yeah, so the beginning of when I started making art, I mean, I like a lot of people too. I was young, very young, started making art, loved it. I was like, I want to be an artist or I want to be a zookeeper. And you get biology and I'm like, nah, science and animals dying. I'm an empath. Like,
it's not going to work. Yeah.
Just admit it happens, but I don't need to surround myself on the daily. So I went to a tech school and I was filming skate videos for my friends at the time and making band flyers for the shows that we would book for our local rock bands and stuff. And yeah, really was like, okay, I'm going to do this 3 periods a day in my high school. So I opted out of some science classes. Like I had to drop down levels and things because there wasn't enough time in a day for labs. And then I was kind of geared into being committed to that by the time I was sacrificing my academics in high school for art. I went to MICA for interactive art after that. I mean, I did a handful of University of the Arts pre-college and Saturday classes in Philadelphia, portfolio prep. I grew up going to museums. Like I've been very art focused a lot my whole life.
Yeah.
I guess after MICA, I was a little bit dejected because of the amount of, you know, student loans for being an artist and the difficulty of trying to make it as an artist at that point in time. It was rough. So I took I hit some rock bottom and did some bad things and, you know, made my way around the festival circuit for a while too. And after that, I was like, this is not, I miss the art. I need to go back to what I love. And it was that real big tear between I need to make money.
Yes.
I need to do what I love. And we talked about this when we spoke before. I think I mentioned the Justin Rosenstein talk, the Do Great Things, which, you know, he has the rose-colored glasses on a little bit and he has plays the opposite side. But ultimately, finding that middle ground between what helps humanity thrive and what helps you thrive. And he gives the example of Gandhi and the businessman and says, makes them a Venn diagram and says you hit right in the middle and that's where you're happy. And that's one of the things too, that talk that spoke a lot to me, that right there. And I started thinking about it and realizing my networking I did, and being, you know what, there's some good people I've met in my travels, some amazing artists that I've come across, and I love making art myself. So I got heavily back into it at that point, and I found a piece of art I started making when I was in college on an old external hard drive, this digital collage. And it was about 8 feet, maybe it was 6 when I found it. Now it's about 8 feet by 4 feet, and you can zoom to different levels of it. And my whole idea behind this, I mean, I'll reveal some of the process too. Like, yeah. I steal so many Googled images for my underpainting. I'm just going to see it. It's building a textural layer in the beginning. But that choice of what am I Googling, I'll sit in a room with my friends and go, yell out a word. Give me something to search. Give me something else. Tell me something cool. And everything that we search, we're learning about something. We're looking at what comes up. Checking out things. And that, again, that's the left versus right brain. I try to focus on finding that intermediate area where it's still fun, because I think all art should be fun.
Hello there in the middle of the episode. You know, just felt like saying hi. I don't have anything to tell you to sign up for, do, purchase, get, find out about. Just have a good time. Just have a good day. Relax. This message is as much for me as it is for you. But seriously, take it easy. There's no reason to worry about anything. You're listening into a podcast. It's a fun conversation. And back to the show.
One of the things I just have not understood working with a lot of organizations is, and regardless of what sector or industry they're in, is that so many people just stop having fun. And I get, like, when we make things habitual, I understand we can lose some of the fun, but like purposely injecting that into our lives is like, it's really, really, really important, because if you don't, you just get burnt out and you just take everything seriously. And like, I take everything seriously, and I'm like probably one of the more lighthearted people I know. And like, I'm really still take shit seriously. So I can only imagine what a clusterfuck it is for most people. So like, I get it, man.
I went up to the artist Calyptus' house recently too. Calyptus, as he says himself, he loves to break all the rules, but he'll have his daughter paint with him. And then he will throw paint at things. He taped a bunch of, paper towel rolls together and put a palette knife on the end of it and was just flinging paint at things when we were there. and because it's so much fun. Right. And like, I wanted to add that too. So, you know, that's the type of art that I really love too, is that even, I think, here's another artist shout out, Stefan Mears said the other day, he said that there's things that digital artists can do, but there's that one stroke that you make that might have even been accidental that would have taken years to replicate, or however long, you know, it's that one thing that you make that you know that couldn't be replicated digitally, at least not easily, you know.
Right.
And when you mix those two things together, ooh, I love that.
That's what it is. It's this alchemy of bridging things and putting things together that creates the magic. And you're talking about like that Googling thing. It's like something I have a book of symbols, and once in a while I'll just randomly flip open one, or like tarot cards, randomly do it. It's fostering the serendipitous circumstances, these synchronicities that can be like beacons or guides that we can look to. And I think trying to like have that be more of an accepted part of how we approach life is very important, because it breaks down these barriers of how we're told things function. And like, in case anyone isn't questioning the nature of their reality at this point in history, like, I don't know what you're paying attention to, but the electors are voting as we're speaking right now today to put in Donald Trump in office. So like, we're through the fucking looking glass.
You talked about wisdom and compassion last week with Simon. Let's hope they have that too, because you know, that's the same. Why would God kill children, put a pipeline there, allow Donald Trump to be president? I mean, you know, the terrible things on this earth right now.
So, I mean, it's, and by all accounts, there have always been terrible things. And I think this tension that terrible things, like, I don't get into the karmic reasons for these things. I do believe that everything that we see is perfect in a sense. And that includes Aleppo, the horrors that are going on, like indescribable. Like when I have to watch a video of Aleppo, when I don't have to, but when I choose to, of like a kid who's holding his infant dead brother. And like, there's all these kids without mothers around. And I'm like thinking of my like 7th month old upstairs and like the dichotomy there. Like there's always horrible shit going on. But the reason I say it's all perfect is I think these situations exist, and like without getting into the karmic implications of why these things exist, because without this friction and this tension in the world, we would live in a state of complacency, right? I always use the samsaric realms of existence in Buddhism and the Vedas too, because there's a higher level. There are two higher in the cyclical illusory world of existence, the 6 cycles. There are 2 stations that are higher than human, right? There's the jealous gods and the gods. Both are viewed as less beneficial or advantageous than humans, because ultimately, if you're a god, everything is fucking great. You don't have any worries in the world. There's nothing going on whatsoever. But guess what? You're still in cyclical existence. You're going to die someday, whether you realize it or not. So imagine the sheer fucking terror, the sheer agony of realizing that moment that your life, as perfect as it's been, is going to end. That's worse than like kind of contemplating and somewhat being able to prepare for death. The jealous gods, while their lives are, you know, we could use celebrities as a manifestation of jealous gods, while their lives are seemingly amazing, they're constantly fighting for power, success, fame with each other. Humans, and we could say this is a very egocentric way, of course humans would put ourselves at the center, and I'm highly aware of that. However, human birth is looked at is so precious because we have this ability to move through all of these realms psychologically, spiritually, but also have the opportunity to dictate where we want to go while being aware of them. So I think the reason things are fucked up on Earth and we have all of these horrible things is because I do believe this is like a spiral of evolution of consciousness. And I think that ultimately we look at these fucked up things and not say, oh, they're fucked up, the world is a shitty place, but we looked up at these fucked up things and go, how do we make sure this doesn't happen? Like, how does this not, how do we make this like really not better? And ultimately realize, no, like, what?
That part is where I'm in agreement with you now. Yeah. I'm like, you know, that's like, I would love to, point of view, like that everything has a reason, you need some but like, no, the how to make it better part, otherwise.
But yeah. Without that, I mean, like, because listen, one of the biggest lessons I've learned, whatever spiritual successes or, you know, poignant moments I've had, is service is one of them. I think if anyone who's truly served in any way, and I'm not at soup kitchens every week. I rarely volunteer in person, but whenever I am actually being generous of my time, spirit, attention, money, whatever, I feel the fucking best. Like that's what it is to me. And like, there are probably many other reasons why it's important, but service, like that's what it's about. So like my cosmology and conception of what the world is and what the universe is based on principles that I think hold up. But like, I love when people like I also don't ever want to be perceived as like a eternal optimist for no reason. That's fucking delusional. Like that's not what I believe, but I do believe that things fit in a way that makes sense. Yeah.
Realist and an optimist.
Yes. Yes.
Work.
Yeah. It definitely is, man. It definitely is. It's doable though. That's the thing. That's what I've realized over time. And like, it's doable, and it doesn't mean everything works out. In fact, it means everything doesn't work out sometimes, but your perception of what doesn't and does work out really pretty much determines what's going on. Right. Okay. So, okay, back to Infinite Bit and your kind of a creative process. So at what point as an artist and realizing you kind of had this network of people, you've had some shitty experiences, what point did you kind of, and I know, again, it might not be a specific instance, but at what series of events kind of led you to be like, okay, now I think I can actually create something that supports artists and really maybe is something for the future that is going to help like a lot of people? Because I think that's ultimately why we connect so much and why Michelle thought of connecting us. So, yeah.
So again, it's the two things, and this is why I've been trying to tiptoe around this question too, is that I did work for a company that stole my stuff, and I'm trying not to give them any press here at all.
Yes, I get that.
Seeing all of the other companies and the way that businesses work at a certain scale, and seeing just the way that artists could be profiting, and that they could all be doing this, that this isn't that difficult. Why don't you just hire the artist to do it, having, you know, and let them make their own money on it? Like, that would be perfect. That was like a really big kicker into where my ethics fall and how a business on a larger scale runs. So, I mean, it's never too late to do internships. It's never too late to take a job somewhere. Like, if it's in an industry that you want, somebody, obviously, if somebody's working a 9-to-5 or they're working at McDonald's right now and they don't have the money to get up and move to LA to try to live their dream, well, find what's closest to you that is a better alternative. And even if you can't do it yet, that's the goal. That's what you're looking for. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I did that mentality a lot of times, even when I left that company. My father also is an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. He owns his own construction business. So I've watched him and his struggles and his successes throughout my whole life. I've grown up around it. And that was also a point that, you know, I've been the one that when I was younger, my friends are talented musicians and they were always playing in bands and I was the one that was organizing the shows. Yeah. I was helping them figure out how to put a tour together or make a flyer or build a website or whatever it was.
Yeah, man, I can feel you.
Yeah. And I'm still, you know, my parents, you know, hey, make this work. The TV out of the, what's the Roku, you know.
This is our station in life, my friend. We just have to help people with their technological needs. Oh, man.
I mean, how, in art school too, like, I smoked some pot in art school, so I had a lot of people that would come by and hang out, and, you know, but because of that, they'd be like, oh, you're techie. We're required to take this computer class. Can we help you with something? And at a certain point, I'd be like, yeah, I've got this final and I'm really struggling with figuring out how this works. And I'd get a lot of help and not to, you know, be like, yeah, pot saved my life and introduced me to people. But, you know,
you're talking to someone who, yeah, I mean, I am a self-professed daily cannabis ingester. And, the truth is that there are many things that marijuana has done for me that some I can adequately express in words that make sense to other people. Some I still am trying to figure out how exactly to put them into words. But I mean, I have no problem saying, you know, in any way, shape, or form that as a social lubricant, for lack of I wish there was a less gross term for that. But as something that has that function, I mean, marijuana is probably one of the best things I've ever found. I know alcohol, a lot of people like, and that can work too. I personally never liked the effects of alcohol. I like getting I like being buzzed, but even buzzes now at this point, it's like, I always end up paying some type of physical price. It's not even that heavy. It's just like, I'd rather not. Can we just not? If weed was legal, and you're in Colorado now, so it is, but if it was federally legal and you just grow your own plants, I mean, that would, I would never touch alcohol.
Oh, and imagine how it would be if it was like craft brews too. Oh man. Woo. I haven't drank in a lot of years. I will have a drink as a celebration once in a while.
Sure, exactly.
It's not my choice.
It's not something that does it for me. And I'm not one of these people, and I've been on this fence, and when I was a vegan, I was very anti everything that wasn't vegan. I'm not anymore. So I try to really say this with, you know, recognizing many people have different proclivities for different things, but alcohol, I don't think is the devil. I don't think it's as bad as the rep it gets. I think the way it's legislated and how culturally we fit it into a lot of our rituals and things we do is pretty dangerous. I mean, I think the data supports that, which is why, I mean, I posted it in the Synchronicity group today on Facebook. I was really shocked and saddened to see that they're classifying CBD as Schedule 1. I mean, this is it's not psychoactive. This is something that literally is saving people's lives, not only their actual lives, but also saving their day-to-day experience of lives. It's mind-blowing.
Close family members of mine need that. So yeah, I'm very affected by that too.
Here's what I'm saying. Essentially, with all of this stuff, is I think we're in the midst of this. I don't think this is even this isn't some brilliant theory at this point. We're obviously in the midst of some transitional period of history, right? And you could argue that that's maybe going on all the time, but we're really in the crux and throes of run right now. And I think as we're seeing kind of this old draconian, top-down, legislative, you know, intrusive government, you know, laws, rule system, patriarchy, putting as many words as I can in here, system start to kind of crumble, I always like Daniel Pinchbeck's analogy of a car that had been driving on the highway, that its engine broke, but it's still moving because of forward momentum. But people in the car like don't realize that their car just broke down. They have to get into another car when it stops. That's kind of where we're going with a lot of the systems that are in place. I mean, I'm personally, again, relatively optimistic for marijuana legislation in this country. And I think as that begins to happen, and I think the reason it's going to happen is the groundswell of support from people who just know that it's not a bad thing anymore and can actually be very helpful.
Supporters, right?
What?
Like Bernie supporters, right?
Oh, Jesus Christ. I mean, you know, I mean, the thing is like, as... yeah, I mean, and this is where we get into when we're talking about the potential pitfalls of these groundswell of things, like, and this is what you're pointing out, is... you have to make sure you have your own shit straight before you go and try to change everything outside in the world. This is why I think you and I and a lot of other people really like creativity and art as a process, because it's such an internal mechanism for, it's like a mindfulness practice, right? I mean, that's what John Simon's book is, exactly that. And when you go inside and constantly have to reevaluate your reactions, your intentions, your aspirations, then you can maybe get to a point where you could go to like a protest and be like, okay, I know I'm at this protest. I'm not here just because I'm angry and pissed off at every circumstance in my life. I'm here because I believe in this. And that's the Gandhis. Those are the Martin Luther Kings. Those people, yeah, man, and they're not perfect people. They did fucked up shit too.
I think those people need to be the ones leading them. Not to say that there's some exclusivity to who should be allowed to protest over what
Agreed.
Reason. Like, angry at your government. Yeah, you know what? You might not be the most intelligent, but you should still be able to be angry at your government and show that.
Oh,
but not that you were. And I just wanted to
clarify. Oh, no. And I think that's totally important to say. Like, I'm not saying it's a prequel. Like, you have to have all your shit figured out, because God knows if that was the case, like, no one would ever do anything, because no one's really figuring all their shit out. What I mean is that you should be aware of your intention for doing these things. So when we're talking about legalizing weed, I am not saying we should legalize weed just because I like to smoke weed and it's been beneficial to me. I think there are clear reasons that I've thought about and analyzed that I think are, you know, you could bring up in a debate that I think are logical and make sense. My point is with all of this shit, right? Trump, marijuana legislation, CBD, artists not having collectives, businesses and corporations that have kind of co-opted the artistic process. What we're seeing though now, and I can, you know, validate this in conversations with you and other people, like, people get this shit is going on. There are people who understand that there are other alternatives, and there is a shitload, there's a tremendous amount of people who are working on this, and they're starting to come together. I mean, I know we spoke about, I meet like, you know, 5 to 10 people now every week who are just doing some really fucking cool shit. And will they all be successful in exactly the way they hope to? No, maybe not. But collectively, the fact that this is going on, that's enough proof for me that this shit is going to change at some point. Maybe not even our lifetimes. Maybe not for 30, 40 years. Who knows? I don't think it's going to be that long. But it's definitely, this is, it's happening. It's a very exciting time to be alive and doing this shit.
I agree. I couldn't agree more with that.
Cool, man. Anything else you want to cover before I get to my questions specifically?
Feel like there is, but I'm looking through here.
I mean, I would like, obviously we'll stay in contact and, you know, we'll probably do other ones of these. And also, I just started gathering information and data on for a project I'm working on centered around creativity. And I definitely would love to have you involved in various stages of it, because I think it's going to be pretty cool. Because it's essentially my intention behind it. I'm trying to figure out where people's pain points are with creativity and what segments of the population are dealing with those. Are you a creative professional? Are you someone who does this for a hobby? Are you someone who doesn't think they're creative but would like to be? And then try to offer up some solutions on how to deal with those. And then third part, which I'm not specifically stating except here, you know, when you get enough people interested around a topic, you can then kind of funnel them to other places, maybe where they resonate with people and really, yeah, exactly. Exactly. So,
I've got other ideas on that for next time.
I'm sure, man. All right. So let me get to my questions and then we will connect soon. I'm super thrilled. And I'd like to point out, I don't know where I'll edit this one in, that you just moved. You're waiting for a pod of all of your stuff to arrive. So I really appreciate you taking the time to do this in this blank canvas surrounding. I totally get it. So let's start.
6 months, this is a rainbow, I promise you.
Yeah, I believe it, man. I can't wait to see it. Okay, so first question, what's your favorite color?
I can't answer all of them. That's so hard.
You can. You can. No.
Well, purple. Like if I had to pick like a color, yeah, I go towards purple.
Awesome. Love it. Love it. What's your favorite number?
9.
I love that too. What's your favorite animal?
Maybe either a large cat or an otter.
Otter. Why an otter?
Otters. I just always like watching them. They're just having fun all the time.
They are. It's true. They are. They frolic in the water.
I volunteered at a zoo once, and they had a line on the ground in the back room where, like, you pull them out to clean their cages. They'd sit in the cell there or whatever, and they had their all the little toys and everything. And there's a line, and I'm like, what's this line about? And they put a stick, and they hit it on the ground over the line, and the claw of the otter just whack, like, because they caught a fish midstream.
Yeah.
So then that was the point I was like, all right, I don't know if otter's my animal, but I've been saying that for a long time. I don't know. And I think I can't. That sharp.
Yeah. Well, you never know, man. Own those claws, man. All right, last question. What's a practical tip that has helped you in your life that you could share with other people?
Practical tip in my life. You can only do as good as you can do every day. And that is the number one thing that I've had to remind myself all the time, is that you can, your best is per day. You know, you can only do that. And we're such future-oriented creatures. And that's where we lose ourselves sometimes, in the anxiety and the stress of the day-to-day. And that's where, even in my move here to Colorado, I found some, you know, some personal solace and some ability to, you know, sit back and be calm about this, is that, you know, I do what I can do every day.
I love it, man.
You know?
I love it. It reminds me of Ashanti Deva quote, which is, if you can't solve your problem, what's the use in worrying? If you can solve your problem, what's the use in worrying?
Exactly.
Do what you can do. All right, man. Dude, thanks so much for coming on. I really appreciate it. Let's connect soon.
I got to say one more thing.
Yes, of course.
Yo, shout out to That's Dope Records. So if anybody else wants to go listen to some really psychedelic bounce music, That's Dope Records and Spankalicious coming out of the Midwest. So we're going to be coming out with a whole line of clothes also, and pulling some artists around on tour with them too.
Do me a favor, email me anything you would want in this episode. I'm going to leave this part in, but anything you want included, I'll make sure it goes out and people can get tuned into what you're digging, man.
Will do. Thanks so much.
Peace, buddy.
I'll talk to you soon.
Thanks to Jerry for coming on and talking while he was moving. I know what it was like right when you moved to do something, so that was incredibly cool of him. Thank you for listening. I really appreciate it. If you like the show, subscribe to it on iTunes, Stitcher, Overcast, wherever. Check out the website, syncpodcast.com. There's stuff on there that's not just the podcast. Sometimes I'm on other podcasts. I don't know if I mentioned this. I probably did, but I had an excellent time on Zach Leary's It's All Happening. A couple weeks ago. Really, I love Zach. He's going places, this kid, I tell ya. But truthfully, thank you for listening. Thank you to everyone who's donated, rated, and reviewed Synchronicity. You guys, really, you're the best. Patrick, you're the super best. I will see you guys next week.